We want to welcome everyone this morning. It is good to see you. Some of you may be just showing up for Sunday school. I don't know. But we did have a time change last night, but we're glad that you could make it here today. We're especially glad to have guests worshiping with us. And if you are a guest, we hope that you'll come anytime you have the opportunity. Also, if you're a guest, if you'll fill out the little tear-off that's on your bulletin, one place on it says welcome and has room for some information under that. But if you wouldn't mind completing that and placing it in the offering plate later in the service, that way we'll have a record of your attendance. But we do want to welcome everyone, including those who are joining us by live stream. It's good to see you. By way of announcements, you see the announcements in the bulletin. Hopefully you've been seeing those on the screen as well. Just one thing that we had in the newsletter, the Beacons will not meet this week. So just take note of that, several different reasons, but we will not be having our Beacons group this week. And then, but the rummage sale has been continued to this week. So if you still want to get things here for that, we would appreciate that. We have, I think, about 10 or 12 different people in groups that this is going to. Also, it's being used to help our kids who are in youth who are going to camp this summer, so they're placing items in it as well, but that will be this week too. You see other announcements listed in our prayer requests. Those who are sick at home or in the hospital in need of prayer, please continue to remember those and our missionaries who are celebrating birthdays today.
Good morning. Let's stand and sing, "Today is the Day."
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow, trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day.
We'll sing that again. Today is the day.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow, trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day.
Today is the day that the Lord has made. Our Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this day that you're allowing us to be a part of. It's now a beautiful day with the sun shining, and we're thankful for that. For the opportunity to be gathered to worship you, we're also grateful. And ask that you would speak to our hearts in this time together, that we might know more fully your will and purpose for each of us. And then that we might go forth from here with the courage to do that which we know you want us to do. Thank you for the opportunity to bring requests before you. You know our hearts' concerns for maybe personal matters or for others. And we're asking that you hear and answer these prayers in a way that will bring the greatest glory to yourself. Lord, thank you again for just loving us, for caring for us, for watching over us even this last week and bringing us to this place today. And even as we embark upon a new week, I pray that we'll be mindful of that which you would have us to do and the opportunities you give us for service. For Lord, every day you're going to place opportunities before us. May we never lose sight of that and ignore those opportunities. Again, speak to our hearts in this time of worship as well. May we hear clearly what you would have us to hear is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's continue to
delighted that you're here today and hope and pray that you're having a good day. It started off with rain last night, and I thought about a year ago when everybody was flooding in the area and thought, now, Lord, we don't need that much again. Let's slack off just a little bit. Hold it back. And I'm glad that we woke up this morning with no rain, and now the sun's come out. It ought to make you feel good, even though I know the time clock of your body hasn't gotten totally changed. That means we can go an extra hour with the service today and you won't even be hungry because you're not used to eating this early yet. Oh, well, okay. We're just glad you're here. And do place the little slip in the offering plate when it comes by if you don't mind when that happens. But let's stand and greet each other in the Lord. And if you're a sixth grader and under, come join us down here at the front if you don't mind.
What are those dances? Can you talk about? She's saying that right.
seated.
Good morning. It's good to see you this morning. I hope you've all had a good week. I was hoping we'd get a little snow or at least a little maybe sleet out of this, but we didn't, did we?
I want to get some snow.
You want some snow? But we're glad that you could be here this morning, even if you had to get up an hour early, okay?
I had to get up at 9:30.
I hope you got up before 9:30, because I think you were here at 9:30.
I was here at 9:30.
And you got up at 9:30, and you were here at 9:30. Did you sleep here last night?
No!
Okay. Have you ever witnessed or seen something happen? And you either run in to tell your mother and dad, or you run to tell one of your friends something that you have seen, something maybe exciting. Can y'all think of something? Ice cream. Okay. I can remember waiting for the ice cream truck when I was little, and when I'd hear it, I would run and tell, "Mommy, Mommy, it's here." But you know, then it was just a dime. That tells you a lot. Yes, sir?
Tell your mom and dad there's a wasp in there?
There's a wasp. That can be something you want to let them know. But, you know, there are all sorts of things. I know a young man that caught a big fish, and he was so excited, he sent out pictures of it. We don't have to point. He sent out pictures. But, you know, when something good happens, we really want to let people know about it. Sometimes, when something not so good happens, like if we see a wreck or see somebody get hurt or something like that happen, we share it with others too. When we tell something to somebody else that we've seen, we testify about it. We tell them what it is. You know, when someone goes to court, when there's been a situation and they go to court, they call it that they're testifying before the judge and jury. They're telling what has happened that they have firsthand seen, or they are sharing their testimony. You know, we share all sorts of things, and some things are good things that we share and some things are not so good. But we each have a testimony about different things. Today in church, we're talking about the testimony that we have about when we invited Jesus into our heart. And that's what I want you to understand. Testifying and a testimony is something that we have experienced firsthand. If I were to go to court and say, "Judge, Kena told me that Aiden told her that her Uncle Brian told her that Wes told him," do you think the judge would listen to me? Because I didn't see it. And by the time everybody else tells about it, it can change just a little bit. That's why you can have witnesses. We sometimes don't always see the same things. Or sometimes when we retell something that someone else has told you, we might miss part of it. But our own personal testimony is what we have experienced ourselves in our own personal life. It's something that nobody else can do for us. It's something that has taken place in our own life. So remember that each of us has a testimony that we can share about what our relationship with God. Now, not everybody yet may have a testimony where they have asked Jesus to come into their heart, maybe because we don't understand it yet, and that's fine. There comes a time when we do understand what's going on, and when we know that God is speaking to us, and we hopefully and prayerfully we make that decision. But think about it. If you have a testimony, that's something you want to share with others, just like you want to share that there's a wasp in the room so nobody else gets stung or something like that. But as we're thinking today, and I just wanted to kind of help y'all know what testimony means. It means to testify or to tell others what we have seen or experienced personally. Let's pray. Dear God, we do thank you for today. And Lord, we thank you for the Bible because, God, we know it does contain testimonies of people who witnessed your miracles back then and the work done, and were here personally on earth when Jesus was here, and through the scriptures they've shared their testimony with us about what they've seen and what they heard and the experiences they had. And Lord, we also have firsthand Jesus' words, and God, the words you want us to hear through the Bible. And God, we're so grateful for that. But Lord, we also pray that as we experience our own testimony and as that decision takes place in our life, God, that we'll realize how important it is, and God, that we'll be willing to share. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Of Jesus, I fain would take my stand. The shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land, a home within the wilderness, a rest upon.
Deacons come forward for the morning offering. We're certainly thankful for the blessing that God has given us and the opportunity to thank Him for that. And as we pray together, Charlie, would you lead us, please, sir?
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great day. We thank you for the sunshine. We thank you for these children who have come to worship with us today. We pray, Lord, that we would be bold in our witness, wise in our understanding, and keen in our insight to the needs of people around us. We thank you, Lord, for the sweet spirit we have in this church. We thank you, Lord, for being here with us today. We ask that you bless these tithes and offerings, that you may be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And I hope and pray it's well with your soul. Those who have the sheets to pass out, if you'll go ahead and be passing those out now to everyone. Message this morning is going to be a little bit different from what we normally do. For the last several weeks, we've been dealing with the harvest theme that our convention is involved in. Not simply because it's just the theme that they have, but because it is biblical. Every home, every person, every home to be prayed for in these next 2 years in the state of Louisiana, and every person to have a witness shared with them in 2017-2018. Now that's the mandate of our Lord Jesus to start with. If you're a child of God, he said, you shall be my witnesses. He didn't say it was an option to consider, but you shall be. And if you're not a witness for him, then you're not doing what he wants you to be doing. And there are those who say, well, give us some hands-on, give us some nuts and bolts. And so as they sometimes say, we're going to hit where the rubber meets the road today and giving you a hands-on way of accomplishing it. Now, we also have some pens that they're going to need. If you need something to write with, because you're going to be writing, we have a whole bunch of pens. You want to pass some of these out? Take them and pass them out. She can help you if you want. And you can keep these pens if you'd like. And if those go and you don't have enough, if you already have a pen, you might not need one. But if you don't have something to write with today, I want you to have one of these so that you can write. I know we're spending just a minute here so that we can make sure everyone has one of those sheets. Someone asked me, where's the outline this morning? This is it. But you needed more room to write than what you'd have on the back of your bulletin. So I'm doing it on a separate sheet today. You're finishing that up. We appreciate those of you who are joining us by live stream this morning. In fact, let's go ahead and cut to that right now while they're passing these out. You who are watching by way of live stream, let me share with you that if you would like one of these sheets, if you'll call the church office at 343-0181, or if you will call 376-3756, either of those numbers, and let us know that you would like one of these sheets. As we go along in the message today, I think you're going to understand the reason why I think it would be good for you to have one and to relate it to us as well. So you can be jotting this down on just a scrap sheet of paper if you want that you have there, but also if you'd like one of these forms, let us know. We'll get you one so that you can also participate in what we're doing today. And we're glad that you've joined us by way of live stream. And even if you're watching this on the archives, you can still let us know, and we'll be sure to get you one of these copies that everyone else is getting here this morning. Everybody have a sheet now? Everybody have a... Yes, I might need one. I've got it in my notes, but just in case. Does everybody have something to write with for when you get to that point? Okay. Oh, somebody needs one. Got another pen? Boots Filter needs one. All righty. In Acts chapter 9, you read of the conversion of Saul, whose name was changed to Paul. This new birth experience happened to Saul as he was on his way to Damascus to arrest more Christians, or believers, or followers of the way, as they were called in that day. They were not called Christian until Antioch, sometime in the place of Antioch, sometime later. So they were believers or followers of the way. And he had letters from the high priest that gave him permission to go and arrest these people, bring them back to Jerusalem where they would be put in prison and later persecuted, many times put to death. He's on his way to the city of Damascus to do that when a blinding light strikes him. And he is blinded by that light. And he hears the voice of God speaking to him. And those around him hear a sound, but they cannot understand what's being said. So we're told. You can read this in Acts chapter 9 and see the full story of it. They led him on into the city of Damascus, where he stayed in a room by himself, and 3 days he was without anything to eat or drink. Simply blind there. You can imagine what kind of prayer meeting that must have been. Almost like Jonah in the belly of the fish. I mean, if you're in the belly of a fish, you're not seeing very much either. And, you know, it was 3 days that he was there. So plenty of time for him to pray and to think, and God had already spoken to him on that road when he blinded him. So the Lord then spoke to a man by the name of Ananias and told him where Saul was, told him the street and the house, and said, I want you to go there. And Saul is there, and I want you to speak to him. He already knows that somebody's coming. Ananias, and it's interesting to me, in Acts chapter 9, verse 13, verse 13. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who call on your name. But the Lord said to him, you go, for he's a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel, for I will show him how many things he must suffer for my name's sake. Ananias, you go ahead and go. I've already prepared his heart. He's waiting for you. You don't have to be afraid of him now. You can imagine if that would be today. It would be similar to the greatest terrorist that we have in the world today, and all of a sudden you're told by God he's in such and such apartment here in Monroe. He is blinded and he's waiting for your visit. Would you like to go visit the person on the number one hit list of our FBI today? You would be pretty nervous as well. And God spoke to him and said, don't be afraid. You go, he's waiting for you. And he went. What I want to share with you, though, is out of chapter 22 of Acts. I want to read the testimony of Paul. His name has been changed from Saul to Paul because his character has been changed. His person has been changed. He's a child of God now. And names meant something in that day. And what your name meant noted your character. And so he's no longer Saul, but he's now Paul. And every time Paul, as he is now, and we know him more as Paul than Saul, but every time he shares his testimony with someone, he follows this outline that you have here. Now, he didn't have the outline, but I want you to see as I read this, how he gives his testimony. Brethren and fathers, and this is Paul speaking, hear my defense before you now. And when they heard that he spoke to them in the Hebrew language, they kept all the more silent. And then he said, I am indeed a Jew. This is his life before he accepted Christ. I am indeed a Jew, born in Tarsus of Cilicia, but brought up in this city at the feet of Gamaliel, taught according to the strictness of our father's law, and was zealous toward God, as you all are today. I persecuted this way to the death, binding and delivering into prisons both men and women, as also the high priest bears witness, and all the council of the elders, from whom I also received letters to the brethren, and went to Damascus to bring in chains, even those who were there to Jerusalem to be punished. Now it happened. Now here's where he's beginning to tell what happened. What was it that caused him to know that he needed God's forgiveness? It happened as I journeyed and came near Damascus at about noon. Suddenly a great light from heaven shone around me. Now most of us probably didn't have a bright light that got our attention. There might have been something else that got your attention though. Could have been somebody's testimony. It could have been a sermon that you heard. It could have been a song that you heard. Many different ways. I had one man tell me one time who was in the hospital, lying flat of his back. He said, Preacher, get this, I'm here because God has gotten my attention. He had to do this to me to get my attention, and all I can do now is lie here looking up. He's got my attention. I don't know what it is that God does has done for you to get your attention, but there is a way that he does it that you know beyond any shadow of a doubt that he has your attention. This, for Paul, was a blinding light that got his attention. And he said, "And I fell to the ground, and I heard a voice saying to me, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?' So I answered, 'Who are you, Lord?' And he said to me, 'I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you are persecuting. And those who were with me indeed saw the light and were afraid, but they did not hear the voice of him who spoke to me. So I said, 'What shall I do, Lord?' And he said to me, 'Arise and go into Damascus, and there you will be told all things which are appointed for you to do.' And since I could not see for the glory of that light, being led by the hand of those who were with me, I came into Damascus. And then a certain Ananias, a devout man, according to the law, having a good testimony with all the Jews who dwelt there, came to me, and he stood and said to me, 'Brother Saul, receive your sight.' And at that same hour I looked up at him. And then he said, 'The God of our fathers has chosen you, that you should know his will and see the Just One, and hear the voice of his mouth, for you will be his witness to all men of what you have seen and heard. And now why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord.' Now it happened when I returned to Jerusalem and was praying in the temple that I was in a trance and saw him saying to me, 'Make haste and get out of Jerusalem quickly, for they will not receive your testimony concerning me.' So I said, 'Lord, they know that in every synagogue I imprisoned and beat those who believe on you. And when the blood of your martyr Stephen was shed, I also was standing by consenting to his death and guarding the clothes of those who were killing him.' Then he said to me, 'Depart, for I will send you far from here to the Gentiles.'" The change in his life because of that bright light that got his attention, and then his life after that. He makes it even more plain in the testimony that he gives before King Agrippa, where he's sharing much the same in the beginning part, but then he comes to the point of what his life was like afterward, and he said, "And therefore, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision." In other words, his life after that was obedience to the vision that God had given him of the mission of his life. I want you to know that every time that Paul shared his testimony, there were these points that were the same, but there were some things that were a little different. As he was, according to who he was speaking to, the emphasis that he felt that he needed to give. He wanted Agrippa to know that, because Agrippa's not a believer. And he wants Agrippa to know that I was obedient to the voice of God, and I went and did this. It was right after this that Agrippa says, "Look, I don't find any fault in this man." And no, Agrippa's the one who says, "You almost persuade me to become a Christian." In the Acts 22 event, it's right after this that they say, the leaders say, "Look, there's no reason for this man to be held." You see, the Jewish people had gotten very upset with Paul. In chapter 22, he's speaking to Jewish people. And that's why he could say, "I was brought up at the feet of Gamaliel." They would know who Gamaliel was. He was one of the great theologians of the day. Very conservative theologian for the Jewish people. There were two different schools of training in that day. And he was letting them know, "I am a Jew who was brought up in this way. I've been very devout." In other words, he's speaking to Jewish people. But when he's speaking to a Roman governor, he speaks to him a little bit differently. Even though he shares much the same testimony, the emphasis at certain places is a little different. And I share that to let you know that when we share our testimony with somebody personally, there are times that we may give emphasis to a certain part of it over another because of who we're talking to and maybe what their experience in life has been as compared to what yours has been. You see, you find Paul sharing basically that which you have on that outline, what his life was like before he accepted Christ, what caused him to know that he needed God's forgiveness, and what did he do to actually receive Christ as Savior, and then what has his life been like since he was saved. That simple outline is a good way for you and me to organize our thoughts about what God has done in our life. What was your life like before you became a Christian? What was it that caused you to know that you needed Jesus as your Savior? What did you do to actually receive Him as your Savior? And what has your life been like since then? We're told that you should be able to give your testimony within a 3-minute span of time, because most people are not going to give you much more than that to talk with them. And if you can share it briefly, then they'll listen to you and they'll hear what Jesus has done for you in your life. For those of you who have accepted Christ as your Savior, you have a story to tell. It's your story. It may be similar to somebody else's story, but it's going to be different too in some places, because it's your story and no one can take it away from you. What's that song? That's my story and I'm sticking to it. You know, when you know what Jesus has done for you, you have a story and it's worth sticking by. You don't have to glamorize it. In fact, that was one of the things that bothered me when I was a child. I would hear evangelists come in and they would spend an entire evening just on their testimony. And more of it was spent on what their life was like before they became a Christian than what it had been like since they became a Christian. And I've shared with you my testimony before, but let me share it briefly with you again. For I was almost 10 years old when I made my commitment to Jesus and asked Him to save me. I had not done anything real bad. I was just a kid. But I came to realize that I needed Christ just as much as those people I'd heard give their testimonies that had done a lot of terrible things. For the Bible says we've all sinned, and I had been taught that verse. And I came to realize that, and it was on a Sunday morning, and I don't remember, my daddy was the preacher. I don't remember what he preached that morning, but I know that I was under conviction. I knew there was something wrong inside, and I needed to do something about it. But I didn't do anything about it. That had happened before, and usually as I got away from church, you know, everything would kind of calm down. But that day it didn't. We got home from church, and Mama was getting lunch ready, and I knew that this was still bothering me. Daddy was back in his study. He took one of the bedrooms, made a study out of it. And I went back there, and I told him what was happening. I said, I need to know how to get saved. I know I've heard you share it before, but I need that there's something going on, and I need to make this, get this right with the Lord. And he talked to me, and right there we prayed, and I asked Jesus to forgive me of my sins and to come into my life and save me. And that night I made it public. But I want you to know, even then it wasn't easy, because even though I had made it and the decision was a settled thing, I'd already prayed and asked Him to forgive me. Just to make that public commitment was still difficult to step out. And I remember asking my mom if she would step out with me. I found out later she only took a step out and then went back where she was sitting. I don't remember all of that part. I know that once I got started, that first step or two was all it took. I was on my way to the front. And my life since then has been one of seeking to do what God wants me to do. I'm grateful for that salvation, because during those teen years, when tempted to do things wrong, I was always reminded of what the Lord Jesus had done for me and what He could do to help me in that moment. And then in seeking of what I'm supposed to do for life, I was praying for God's will to be done. I wanted to know. And I came up with some thoughts of what I thought it should be, and as I continued to pray, I knew that wasn't it. And finally, it became very clear to me that God wanted me to be a preacher, a minister of His word. And I'd heard so many testimonies of people that had run from God. What had happened to them. I didn't want to be like that. I wanted to know beyond any shadow of a doubt that was His will, and then I was willing to do it and made that commitment and have never looked back since then. And through these years of ministering, you know, people say sometimes, how do you do it? Well, you know, when that's what God wants you to do, you can't do anything else. And I'm grateful for the opportunities He has given me to share His word and to be with me and to strengthen me in those times of need. But I'm thankful for that salvation point, because that was the beginning of all else that took place in my life as well. Now, I've asked a couple of people to share their testimony today, because I want you to hear that it's not just one way. There's one way to be saved, but I mean it's different for each of us. And I've asked my wife if she will share her testimony with us this morning. Some of you might have heard this in the past, but I want her to share it with you today, so that you might hear from the preacher's wife once in a while. All right, Luna?
I'm on.
Yes.
I wrote my testimony on October the 7th, 1973. That was 2 days before Christy was born. And I got to thinking, you know, if something would happen to me, would they know where I would be after I leave this world? And I thought, well, I'm just going to put it down so they'll know. So I got it out the other night, and I always tell William, if something happens to me, go to that drawer and get this out, and this shares what Jesus was to me. And I had some older adult neighbors that would stop and pick me up when I was 4 years old to go to Sunday school in church. My parents did not, they only went to worship service. And then I had an uncle that became a Christian not long after that, and he and his family started to church. And he asked me to go with them because they were next door neighbors too. Anyway, we went to church every church service, morning, night, whenever, every activity that was going on, we were there. But I remember that after he became a Christian, he started talking to me and he would give me the plan of salvation. He would use the Bible and show me where I needed to ask God to forgive me of my sins and trust Him. But I knew I hadn't done anything wrong, as young as I was. I mean, you know, I hadn't done any really bad stuff. But I knew that I was very unhappy in church. I'd been there since I was 4, and I was so unhappy with all those people. I did not want to be around the people. But it was because I knew my life was empty without Jesus. And then one day at the age of 14, realizing I was a sinner, I prayed and asked Jesus to come into my heart and forgive me of my sins and accepted Him as my Savior. And that there was a complete change in my life. I just could not do enough for the Lord. I wanted all my friends to know of this salvation experience and that they too could have this same Savior that I had accepted. And you know, it was a great and wonderful experience. And I always felt that if Jesus could be that good to me and die for me, that I should be willing to serve Him wherever He wants me to. And that's my story.
All right. Okay, and then I've asked Gene Ford to come and share his testimony with us. A little bit different, and yet Jesus still saves.
Well, you have that outline now, if you would. Begin at the very beginning of it there. Put a number one by that first, what my life was like before I accepted Christ, and then two by what caused me to know that I needed God's forgiveness, and then turn over on the other side and put a three and a four. And I would begin with mine. Although I was raised in a Christian home where we read the Bible and prayed almost every night, I attended church regularly and was even baptized when I was a child. But deep down, I knew things weren't right in my life. I really was an insecure, selfish person that was caught up in the ways of the world. But yet I knew that I needed to do something different because, as Brother Smith just shared, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Point number two. I was reading from the book of John one Saturday night, and I ran across John 14:6, where it said, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. That really got my attention, and I think at that point is when I started to become convicted of my situation. I went the next morning to a Sunday school class, and in that Sunday school class that day, the teacher gave a real simple plan of salvation. She said, it's as easy as ABC. A, you have to admit that you're a sinner and can't save yourself. B, you have to believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. And then C, you confess him with your mouth and believe in your heart that God had raised him from the dead and you will be saved. She also called on a young lady that morning in that Sunday school class to give her testimony. At the end of that testimony, she said this, if I died today, I know I would go to heaven. I wanted to say that, but I knew at that point in my life I couldn't say that. So, point number three, I went into worship service that morning. It was in this church. I was sitting in about the third pew, sitting next to Grandma Rodden, which is Connie's grandma. And I had my three-year-old son in my lap. And this preacher, I don't know how he knew as much as he did about me, but everything he said that morning just seemed like it was directed straight at me. And, of course, I was under conviction. And then he said, those of you that would like to come to the front, and by coming, receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, come to the front. I had that little three-year-old boy in my lap, and he was asleep. I didn't ask Grandma Rodden, but I just laid him over in her lap, and I got up and went down to the front. And that preacher talked to me and prayed with me. And at that point, I had a calm and a peace that I'd never had before. And I also knew that I could say that if I died today, I know I'd go to heaven. Point number four. After I became a Christian and knew that I had that peace and calm, I knew that God had plans for me. I knew he didn't save me to sit. He had ministry and things for me to do. And I'm very grateful that right here at Lakeshore Baptist Church, I've had opportunity to do a number of different kinds of ministry. I've been able to go on 17 different mission trips out of the country to share the good news of Jesus and to share with people there. I also have been involved in what is called Lay Renewal Weekends. I've been in churches throughout Louisiana, Arkansas, Mississippi, and Texas, sharing my little four-point outline story with people that I could share with. But the greatest joy I have in sharing my little four-point outline is to go to one-on-one with a person and be able to share that story. And hopefully, when I share it, that they would be willing to accept Jesus. Point five, I asked Brother Smith if I could do a point five. The very first time I shared this four-point outline with anybody, I had, right after I was saved, I found that was the greatest thing that ever happened in my life. I need to learn how to share it with other people. So I went to West Monroe First Baptist Church to a witness training class there. And the very first night, they taught us to write out your testimony on this four-point outline. Well, I got about halfway through mine, and this guy that was leading the session, he said, now you turn around and give it to the person behind you. I was kind of embarrassed because I didn't have mine. But when I turned around, the lady behind me, she said, could I be first? I said, yes, ma'am. I said, you be first. Go right ahead. And so she just rattled hers off like that. And I said, ma'am, I'm sorry. I don't have mine finished, but I'll assure you before I go to sleep tonight, I'll have it ready. Well, they gave you a little red ribbon to put on your shirt so that when you started Monday at work or school or wherever you were, you put that red ribbon on and people would walk up and say, well, why you got that red ribbon on? And it was for you to say, it's to remind me to tell you about the greatest thing that ever happened in my life. And then you would share your four-point outline. Well, I was coaching at West Monroe Junior High, had early morning duty, drove up in the parking lot that morning and I was about to get out of my truck, and here comes this young man. Hey, Coach, how you doing? Well, I'm doing good. Coach, what are you doing with that red ribbon on your shirt? Well, I confess, I kind of choked. I said, well, I tell you what, you come back to my office at lunch recess, and I'll tell you what that red ribbon's about. Knock, knock on my door at lunchtime. He came in. He said, now, Coach, you told me you'd tell me what that red ribbon was about. Now I want to know what it's about. I said, well, Greg, it's to remind me to tell you about the greatest thing that ever happened in my life. And so I shared my story and shared the gospel with him. And I said, now, Greg, if you would like to have that happen to you, you can pray this prayer after me, and God will save you. And so I prayed this prayer. I said, dear Lord Jesus, I realize I'm a sinner and need your forgiveness. I believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins. And right now, I want to invite you to come into my heart and life and save me. And Greg prayed that prayer. He later went and joined West Monroe First Baptist Church, was baptized, and I hope he is still serving the Lord. I haven't been in contact with him lately, but to say to you, there's no greater joy than your own personal testimony. Amen. Is when you're able to share it with somebody else and you see them accept Jesus.
Amen.
And it is the greatest thing that's ever happened in your life if you've been saved, because nothing greater. You see, decisions you make in this life are going to end when this life is over. I don't care how big a decision, the choice of a mate in life, the choice of a profession in life, where you're going to live, all kind of decisions that we make in life. But the greatest decision, because it determines your eternity, is what you do concerning Jesus. Now I want you to take the outline that you have. If you're a child of God, you have a story, and I want you to write it down. As you can tell from these testimonies that you've heard this morning, different ages. From mine, I was the youngest of this group. I was almost 10. My wife was 14. Jean was an adult. I think the oldest person I've baptized since being here at Lakeshore was 70 years old. I have baptized older people at my former church, but all in between. You see, as long as there's breath to breathe, if you've never made such a commitment of your life to Jesus, He's given you that opportunity to do that. Because again, when this life is over, you don't come back to make a decision then. It's determined while you're here. And then the greatest joy about giving your life to Him now is that you have a life to give Him. You have opportunity to have Him walk with you and help you in this life. You see, you don't face things alone. You don't face the difficulties alone. You have His help along life's way. Now, briefly write your story. Fill in those blanks that are there. You have lines to write it on. Now let me, for those of you who are writing, again, these questions just help organize your thoughts of what was your life like before you accepted Christ. Doesn't have to be long, but just what was it like? And then what caused you to know that you needed God's forgiveness? Was it a revival? Was it a testimony of someone? Was it a song or a scripture verse, as Gene shared a moment ago, that got him thinking? How was it that God got your attention? Did a friend talk to you? And then what did you actually do to receive Christ? In some form or fashion, it needed to be that you asked Him. Because you see, no one else can make this decision for you. It's a personal decision. Others can talk to you about what they've done, but until you ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins and to come into your life and save you, it doesn't happen. You can be under conviction. You can know there's a need, but conviction's not salvation. Going to church won't save you. It's when you actually ask Him to forgive you and to come into your life and save you, that's when He does the work. He'll never force Himself on anybody. He will encourage us. He'll bring conviction. He'll disturb and upset your life because you know you need it. He'll in some way try to get your attention, but you can keep ignoring Him if you want to. And He'll never force Himself upon you. Now, while you're writing, those of you who have a story to write, let me talk to those of you who might not have a story to write this morning. You need Christ as much as anybody else and everybody else. You see, when Jesus came to die on that cross, it was for all, everyone. Because the Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Now, what does that mean, come short of the glory of God? We all have sinned. You've told a lie. You've done something. In fact, if you look at Revelation 21:8, you find that liars are put in right in there with the whoremongers and idolaters and adulterers and all these others that the Bible says are going to spend eternity in hell. A liar is just as bad as the others. You know, it's interesting how we categorize sin. Those things that people do that are horrible, like murder and all those things, those are bad sins. But usually the things that you do are not so bad. Have you ever noticed that? Those are on the bottom of the list. But in God's eyes, sin is sin. And that way you spell it, S-I-N, right in the middle of it is you, is I. I is right in the middle of sin. And it's that old sin nature that causes you to do whatever it is you've done. He forgives us of our sins, plural, and forgives that old sin nature. He changes that nature. He wants to help you with that. And you see, whatever it is, the sins that you do may be different from somebody else, but it's still caused from that sin nature that sends everybody to hell who doesn't trust Jesus. So we've all sinned. Now, what does it mean, come short of the glory of God? Because you might look at somebody else and you say, well, I haven't done the things they've done. No, you might not have. But I guarantee you, you're short of the glory of God. Let me get this. God's glory is way up here, isn't it? Who God is way up here. Do you come anywhere close to being who God is or as good as God? No. We fall far short of the glory of God. And only if you can be as good as God can you get to heaven without needing forgiveness and salvation. You see, that's where the law of the Old Testament fell short. If you could keep the law of God, and even today, if you could keep the law of God perfectly, you could be saved by the law. But it's impossible. You can't keep the Ten Commandments perfectly. You might keep some of them, but if you fail at any one point, you've sinned. You've broken them all, the Bible says. And that was what the Jewish people kept reminding the Jews about. We've tried and we've not been able to. We brought our sacrifices, and because it wasn't good enough, we had to keep bringing sacrifices to ask forgiveness. But Jesus came and was the ultimate sacrifice. He died on that cross for you and me. That by our accepting that gift that He gave, His life, we could be forgiven and have a new life in Christ. Bible says it's like it's being born again. It's a whole new life. We're new creations, new creatures in Christ Jesus, new creations in Christ Jesus. It's a whole new start. Slate's like wiped clean. I don't care what age you are. It's a new beginning in Jesus Christ. Now, for those of you who've been writing, if you finish that before the service ends, I'd like for you to give it to me at the conclusion, or give it to Beth at that door, or leave it on the front pew here. I'm going to make a copy of it and give you back your original. If you haven't completed it, I want you to take it home and I want you to finish it and then bring it back. And again, I'd like a copy of it, and I'm going to tell you why. I heard many years ago, and it's been something that's come back to my mind often, but I've just never done it, but I just felt this is the time to do it. I want us to have a Lakeshore Book of Life. Now, what I mean by that, when you've become a Christian, your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life in heaven. And that's the most important book to ever have your name in. But I'd like to have a Lakeshore Book of Life. Those who are Christians, who are part of the church family. Now, why would that be important? Either myself or somebody else one day, unless Jesus comes back first, is going to be called upon to do your funeral. Wouldn't it be great to be able to go and take that sheet out of that book and say, this is what that person said about their relationship to the Lord, how they got to know the Lord, and what their life was like after that. You're preaching your own funeral. We've often said we preach our funeral, don't we? But wouldn't it be great that I could take this that you've written, make a copy, put it in that book, and whenever that takes place, and again, you're liable to outlive me, so it'd be somebody else. But whenever it is, somebody else could take that sheet and share your own words of what happened in your life. That's why I'd like to have a copy of it, to have a Lakeshore Book of Life in order to have a memory of that event. Now, what did the Bible say about our need? We all have that need. No one's exempt from the need. We might ignore and try to put him off, but what we do concerning Christ is our decision. I want you to bow your heads with me right now. And if you've never trusted Jesus as your personal Savior, but somehow in this time of thinking and talking about it and hearing testimonies even of others, you realize I've never had such an experience with the Lord. I don't have that assurance that if I were to die today, that I'd go to heaven. I don't know that I would. I'm not sure I wouldn't. I hope I've done enough good things. That's usually what people say. But I want you to know, as good as you can try to be, and as good as you are, it will never be good enough to get you into heaven, the Bible said. Only the forgiveness of Jesus that was accomplished through his shedding of his blood on that cross. And we're getting close to the celebration of that at Easter. But only that is going to forgive you and make you where you can come into heaven. You say, I'm not worthy of that. No, none of us are worthy of that. But he did it because he loved us. And he offers us the opportunity to be forgiven. And we can accept it or reject it. And if this morning you would accept that, I want you to come and share with that with me during our hymn of invitation. Just share with me. I want to be saved. I want to know that whatever happens and whenever it happens that I'd leave this world, that I'm going to spend eternity in heaven. I want to know beyond any shadow of a doubt, it's settled. If it's not settled, it's settled. You can settle it this morning before you leave here. If you're a child of God, share that testimony with us. Share what Jesus has done for you. Because it is the greatest thing that's ever happened in your life. Jesus, as we come to you now, speak to our hearts, help us to know your will and purpose for our lives, and then help us to have the courage to do it. We know you'll always encourage us. Help us to just yield to you, that your will can be done, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand to sing our hymn of invitation, without him, you're lost, but with him, you're saved. As we stand to sing, if you feel led of God to come, I encourage you right now to come.
Without him, I could do nothing. Without him,
maybe that you're already saved, and there's another decision you need to make of rededicating your life. It may be to move your membership to go to work with God's people here. It may be a call to full-time vocational service. Whatever God's placed upon your heart to do, you come even now. What's God saying to you? There a need in your life? Maybe just a need to come and pray at the front. Whatever it be, you let God have his way in your life right now.
Jesus.
just feel the presence of God, don't you? Amen. If there's some way that we can talk with you, if it's not a settled matter with you, let me know. We'll sit down and we'll talk. We'll, over a cup of coffee, glass of water, toothpick, whatever, you know, we can just talk. Because it is the most important decision you'll ever make. And know this, that even as a child of God, there are the struggles of life still. They're still going to be there. But the Bible promised, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. He will strengthen you. He will help you. Just lean on him. There have been some rededications. There have been some repentances this morning. And I just pray that in your life, you've done what God's wanted you to do. And if not, that he'll give you that opportunity to do so. Because again, it's what's needed. Don't forget, tonight's service begins at 6. With a change of time, we'll go back to 6. But it'll be plenty of daylight even after services are over. For those who don't drive at night, you can still get home before dark. So, and there won't be a choir practice this afternoon, so 6 o'clock services this evening. Hope you'll be here. Okay. Brother, I'm going to be out this evening, so Brother Gary's going to be filling in for me. So you've heard what the subject matter is going to be. Let's pray together and pray for one another as we go from this place today. Scotty Barnes, would you lead us in prayer, please, sir?